Good evening to all. Welcome to this 42 lecture of computational fluid dynamics. In the previous lecture, we completed our discussion on the topic of turbulence and its modeling. So in this lecture, we will specifically talk about one very, very important topic, which is nothing but related to the boundary conditions. Okay, so boundary conditions are very, very important for CFD simulations, because if we are selecting the wrong boundary conditions in any of our physical formulation of the problem, that will be actually resulting in some random results and errors in our final outcome, whatever we are looking for. Okay, so that's why boundary condition is very, very important. Selection of the boundary condition is very, very important. So apart from this, we will also try to see that when we are selecting some boundary condition, how to computationally incorporate that boundary condition into our discretized set of equations. Okay, so we are having number of boundary conditions available. For example, we are having some, if you have done some CFD simulations, you might be aware of some of the popular conditions. You might be knowing about inlet condition, then there is some outlet boundary condition, there is some wall boundary condition, there is some boundary condition in the like solvers, where we are having, say, symmetry condition, symmetry boundary condition, then something like there may be periodic boundary condition. So periodic, or we also call it as cyclic boundary condition. So what are the physical meaning of these boundary conditions, and how we incorporate these boundary conditions into discretized form of governing equations, that we will try to see in this particular lecture. Okay, so now let me give you the first idea about arrangement of grid structure at the boundaries. So here, if you see, I have taken one boundary. So this hatched line over here is nothing but some solid, it represents some solid boundary over here. So one is this solid boundary, and another solid boundary we have over here. So another solid boundary, you can see, and this is one solid boundary we are having. Okay, so what we are calling, let us consider this particular solid boundary as nothing but, say, from here our domain is starting. So whatever this dashed line over here is, this dashed line shows that from here our actual simulation domain is starting. So this is our nothing but inlet boundary, and this bottom over here is, say, some physical boundary, some physical solid boundary, which we can consider as wall. Okay, now here comes the important question. So when we are having this grid arrangement, so you can see over here I have two types of lines. Few are the solid thick lines, and few are the dashed thin lines. Okay, so solid thick lines are nothing but corresponding to the scalar control volumes. For example, this solid over here represents nothing but a scalar control volume, and these dashed lines, so over here, if I take this dashed control volume, for example, over here, say this dashed control volume, this is nothing but a vector control volume. So you can see that at this inlet boundary, some of the nodes of scalar control volume actually are outside the physical domain. Okay, similar thing you can see in case of this bottom solid boundary also. So here also some of the nodes of scalar control volume are outside, and some of the nodes and for like this another control volume, which is a vector control volume, you can see this solid boundary is nothing but acting as one of the cell face of this vector control volume. Okay, so this we are actually selecting over here nothing but our staggered type of grid. Now let us consider that at any point I have some parameter phi, and say at any boundary, at this bottom boundary, I want to specify the value of this parameter as, say, some value phi fix. Okay, so when we specify these values, obviously you have seen while we talked about discretization of convection diffusion equation, that when we are having the solid boundaries present, what we have to do, we have to actually over there treat the boundary nodes differently. Okay, so treating boundary nodes differently will be, once again, you have to do some changes in your code. Okay, in order to treat the boundary nodes differently. So there is some way with the help of which we can actually treat the boundary nodes also in usual fashion as we are doing for the internal node. So let me just explain that point. So in terms of convection diffusion equation, if you recall our governing equation, including the source term, including the linear approximation for source term, where we were writing S bar into delta V as nothing but SU plus SP into phi P. So for this type of situation, our discretized form of the equation was AP plus SP into phi P equal to sum of all the neighboring nodes into coefficients of all neighboring nodes into multiplied with phi NB, and plus we were having some constant intercept from here. So SU. Okay. Now say at I have to apply this particular equation, which is applicable for internal nodes. I have to apply this equation at some boundary. So when I have to apply this equation at boundary, what I will be doing now, let me consider that I want to give this phi fixed value at the boundary. So what I will do, I will assign SU as say a very large value. I am considering over here, say 10 to power 20 times phi fixed. So this I have chosen for SU, and for SP also, let me consider high value as some high value 10 to power 20. So when I'll be substituting this over here, my equation will be becoming AP plus 10 to power 20 into phi P, and this is equal to summation of ANB into phi NB plus 10 to power 20 into phi fix. Okay, so now this equation I have written in an usual fashion, but just to treat the equation for boundary as well as the internal nodes in a same fashion, what I have done for the boundary node, when I am applying this particular discretized equation for the boundary node, I have judicially selected the values of these source terms SU and SP. Okay, so SU I have given very large value multiplied with the value which I want to satisfy, and SP I have given 10 to power 20. So now corresponding to this large value, so corresponding to 10 to power 20, my value of AP and summation of ANB into phi NB will be actually very, very small. So if I neglect this AP and ANB phi NB, I'll be just getting equation finally as 10 to power 20 into phi P equal to 10 to power 20 into phi fix. And finally, I will be getting nothing but phi P equal to phi fix. Okay. So this is one way of judicially using the source term in order to treat the boundary nodes. So here we are specifying value also, but we are treating the boundary nodes in a usual fashion as we are treating the internal nodes. Okay, so this point is clear.
Yes, sir. So, sir, will it work for the velocities also?
Yes, it works for everything. Yes. Now, let us try to see one by one first that what are the boundary condition we have. So first I'll be speaking about inlet type boundary condition. So in case of inlet type boundary conditions, what we generally have, if we physically consider, we are having the known value of the velocity at the inlet. Say if I consider that I have some flow through a pipe. So at the inlet, say if some constant value of velocity is given, say u is equal to 5 meters per second. So, and say I have number of cells over here. So I can say that at every node of the cell, value of velocity will be nothing but 5 meters per second. Okay. Sometimes if we are having properly calculated velocity profile, fully developed velocity profile, then I may be having say parabolic velocity profile. So for these nodes which are close to the wall, I'll be having low velocity. Then when I'll be moving further down, so velocity value will be increasing and center will be having highest velocity. So I'll be getting velocity profile something like this. Okay. So it means that in case of inlet boundary conditions, from the physical perspective, you have to only learn one thing, that you are knowing the value of velocity. That may be constant, that may be any other value, but value of velocity is given to you. Now, what we have to do, we have to supply this value of velocity into our flow equation. Okay, so now I have taken the example of an inlet boundary. So if you can see over here, this dashed line, this dashed thin line shows nothing but our inlet boundary. So this is my inlet boundary over here. And at this inlet boundary, say I want to assign some value of velocity as u in. Okay, so now you can see that through this boundary, some of the scalar nodes are actually outside the domain, and exactly to this physical boundary, our faces of the control volume, which are part of, so this is nothing but, you can see this is our scalar control volume and this is our vector control volume. So you can see I have represented over here U cell. Okay, so I will not be solving this U cell. Why I will not be solving this U cell? Because at this boundary already velocity is known to me. So when I have to start solving the U momentum equation, I have to solve U momentum equation from point I equal to 3. Okay, so this is one very, very important point, because at this boundary already we are knowing the value of velocity. So we need not to solve momentum equation for this boundary. U momentum equation we have to only start solving from point I equal to 3. Okay, and this value is actually known to us, which we are considering as equal to U inlet. Similarly, if I go at the same boundary, I have to also solve Y momentum equation. Okay, so if you see V cell, so this is my vertical velocity cell over here. So you can see this is vertical velocity cell, and this vertical velocity cell is actually also coinciding with the physical boundary. Okay, and for this vertical velocity cell, when we will be solving it, obviously we will be requiring some data from the previous point also. Okay, so now there will be one situation that if our flow is parallel to x-axis, in that case only we will be having u in velocity, and this v in velocity we have to consider equal to 0. However, if we are having the flow which is entering at certain angle, then we will be having some contribution for u velocity and some contribution for v velocity. So in that case we have to take these inputs differently. Okay, now one important point you can see over here, though we are knowing the value of velocity at this physical boundary, for U cell it is acting at this physical boundary only, but for V cell, whatever this specified value of velocity is, that is actually acting on cell face, on scalar cell face, which is actually outside the physical boundary of the domain. Okay, so this is about U cell and this is about V cell. Okay, now one important point, okay, before that let me talk about scalar cells also. Then we are having some scalar cell over here. So you can see this is one scalar cell, and which is lying outside the domain, and this is the scalar domain, this is scalar cell actually, which is lying inside the domain. So when we will start solving the equation, we will start our solution from capital I equal to 2. Okay, because outside we are not interested in finding out the value of the scalar variables. Okay, we are only interested in finding the value of scalars inside. So that's why I will be doing my discretization for scalar cells from I equal to capital I equal to 2. Similarly, so this is, I am representing over here as P dash cell. So one similar to that, when we are having say transport of any other scalar associated with the flow, then I have to consider parameter phi also. Okay, so for parameter phi, what I have to do here, I have to solve this particular cell, because P dash and phi both are scalar, so their cells are also coinciding. So for this phi parameter also, we will start solving from I equal to 2 only. Okay, now in terms of inlet boundary condition, let me just explain you one thing, that at this boundary, so when we are solving for the U cell, we are solving for U cell from point I equal to 3. And at this physical boundary, the value of velocity U in is actually known to us. Okay, so once the value of U in is known to us, so corresponding to this physical boundary, we need not to solve our U momentum equation, because already we are knowing the value of velocity. So under this circumstance, what will happen? U star for this phase. So if I take this has nothing but, because we are solving I equal to 2 scalar cell for pressure correction equation. So this will be my corresponding scalar cell. So while I will be solving this scalar cell for pressure correction equation, we consider always that there is some difference between u star and actual u. So for this boundary of the scalar cell, u star will be equal to u in, which is known to us. So that's why we have to specify p dash value corresponding to this left face as nothing but equal to zero. Okay, so when we are having inlet boundary condition, we have to consider that u velocity exactly coincide with the inlet boundary, and for that, corresponding to that, we need not to solve the x momentum equation. And as we are knowing the value of velocity, so we need not to provide any guess. Guess will be equal to nothing but the known value of velocity. So that's why for this boundary, value of p dash will be equal to zero. Okay. And while we will be introducing this into our pressure correction equation, considering this as nothing but a west face of the scalar cell, we can even specify aw cell equal to zero, although p dash for the west face is also equal to zero only. Okay, so this is how we can specify. So you can see over here, while we will be solving this scalar cell, corresponding to this p dash cell, when we will be selecting the boundary value for p dash inlet, that we will be taking as equal to zero. Okay, so this is how we treat the inlet boundary condition for velocity and pressure. And apart from that, if we are having, say, turbulence also involved, let us consider I am using some K epsilon turbulence model. So if I am using K epsilon turbulence model, I have to also specify value of K inlet and epsilon inlet as boundary conditions. Okay. And for pressure, I need not to specify any boundary condition. So this is one very, very important point. Let me repeat again. When we are knowing the value of velocity at inlet, we need not to specify any value of pressure, because pressure correction directly we can substitute equal to zero. Okay, so this is one very, very important point. And from which point we have to solve equation, that also I have specified. And along with that, let me also tell you that along with the flow equations, if we are solving scalar transport equation also, so we have to specify value of scalar phi inlet also. Okay, so you can see over here, this is our scalar control volume which we want to solve, and this scalar node is actually lying outside the physical boundary. So whatever inlet value we will be specifying for scalar quantity phi in, that will be acting at node outside the domain. So now I have to solve for this. While I'll be solving this west node, I'll be calculating phi w. That phi w will be nothing but equal to phi n. Okay, so is this point clear, how inlet boundary condition works in computational modeling?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Let me now go to the next boundary condition. So next boundary condition is actually outlet type boundary condition. So in case of outlet type boundary condition, what we do, this boundary condition is something which mainly we specify by considering that our domain is so large that whatever the outside velocity coming, that is actually coming under the condition of fully developed flow situation. Okay, so please remember this point. We only apply outlet boundary condition when we are having surety that our flow within the domain is actually fully developed. So when the flow within the domain is fully developed, what kind of condition exists for velocity? Let us consider flow through a pipe. So initially you will be finding that boundary layers will be developing from the inlet up to some point, and we will be having development of velocity profile. Okay, say at this point I'll be having some this velocity, then at another point I'll be having this velocity, and at this point I'll be getting certain parabolic velocity profile, and beyond this point my velocity profile will not change. So when my velocity profile is not changing along the x direction, I can simply call that my del u by del x is nothing but equal to zero. Okay, so this is one important consideration. I can write del u by del x equal to zero. So this is the physical boundary which we can only apply, physical boundary condition which we can only apply when we are sure enough that inside the domain flow is actually fully developed. Okay, now let us consider this as our outlet boundary. So this dashed line over here is nothing but representing our outlet. Okay, so this is my outlet over here. Now, for this case, let me consider that Ni is my total number of cells, and this is actually corresponding to capital. So this is corresponding to scalar node. So once again, here also scalar nodes are outside the physical boundary, and this particular node is actually coinciding with the physical boundary. And the U volume, U cell, which we will be solving, that will be nothing but small I equal to capital Ni minus 1. So this U cell I will be solving, and for this U cell, from the boundary condition only, we will be getting data in terms of the previous value. Okay. Similarly, for outlet boundary, you can see this is my V cell. So for V cell, if I have to solve this cell, I have to specify a value outside the boundary. Okay. Then correspondingly, scalar cells also, you can see this is our P dash cell at outlet boundary, and this is some scalar cell phi. Okay. Now, as I told you that del u by del x has to be zero. So if del u by del x is zero, I can simply mention that del u by del x, which is equal to, by using just linear interpolation or linear extrapolation, this is my one u cell and this is my another u location. So I can simply write u at point capital Ni minus u at point capital Ni minus 1 divided by delta x will be equal to 0. So if I substitute this from this fully developed boundary condition, I can simply say that u at Ni will be nothing but equal to u at Ni minus 1. So as I am directly getting the value of u at Ni as nothing but no value in the just in the immediate previous node, so I need not to solve this particular velocity cell. As I need not to solve this particular velocity cell, so whatever the scalar cell I am getting over here, for this scalar cell, I can directly substitute value of P dash correction as nothing but equal to 0. Okay. Now, similar to this U velocity profile, I can write for scalar also as del phi by del y equal to 0. And for that case, I will be getting nothing but phi at point Ni equal to phi at point Ni minus 1. Okay. So this type of boundary condition works very well for phi and other parameters, for example, turbulent kinetic energy and rate of its dissipation. However, in terms of velocity, when we use simple algorithm, sometimes this particular condition does not give us a full conservation of the continuity equation. Okay. So under such conditions, what we do, under such conditions, we do one modification. We consider u and I to be nothing but equal to u and I minus 1 multiplied with m in divided by m out. So what is this m in and m out? Let me just explain. Okay. So m in is something which is the total mass flow rate coming from the inlet. So m in is something, total mass flow rate coming from the inlet, and m out is something. Initially, first we will be considering that u and I is equal to u and I minus 1 only, and based on that, for each cell, we will be calculating the flux m out. Okay. And whatever this value of m out we will be getting by using this value, that we will be using over here for correcting our velocity value at the outlet node. And this corrected velocity value Ni is actually used for further computations of x momentum equation. Okay. So this boundary condition is clear to all, or is there any doubt?
Yes.
Okay, let me then move to next boundary condition. So next boundary condition is actually wall boundary condition. So wall boundary condition, say we are having some physical wall over here. So one consistency, you can see that every time our vector cell faces will be coinciding with the wall, and scalar cells will be actually, scalar nodes will be outside the physical boundary. So this one cell represented over here is nothing but our U cell. So this is my U cell, and another cell I am having over here close to the wall is nothing but this is my V cell, because this cell I cannot solve So this is my another cell which I will be solving. So for V, Y momentum equation, we will start it solving from small j equal to 3. So from here, we will be start solving Y momentum equation. And for U momentum equation, we have to solve it from capital J equal to 2. So from here, we will be solving actually U momentum equation, because at this node, we want to calculate value of U. However, at this, we are knowing already the value. Okay. Now, then comes the corresponding scalar cell. So this is nothing but the V cell for the top boundary. So like we are having bottom boundary, we may have one top wall. So let us not consider top wall now at the moment. Let us focus on bottom wall with a scalar cell, because for top wall also similar formulation will be applicable. However, nodes will be just moving in the reverse fashion. Okay. Now let us talk about this particular as our scalar control volume. Okay. So when we are having the solid impermeable wall, in that case, always we will be finding that if wall is stationary, we will be finding u velocity is equal to 0. Okay. So directly I can do this velocity vector. See, one is my this velocity, and so this particular velocity I can simply set as nothing but, so this is my velocity over here, you can see. So this particular velocity I can simply set as nothing but u equal to 0. Similarly for V cell, you can see now V cell is actually this vector, V vector is coinciding directly with the solid wall. So if it is impermeable boundary, then this V vector also we will be equating equal to 0. Now as from no slip and impermeable boundary only, we have got these values. So for Y momentum, I can solve this cell. But for X momentum, this bottom cell, I will not be solving. Okay. So if I am not solving this particular cell, I am starting my computation procedure of X momentum from capital J equal to 3. So for this bottom cell, because of the wall, whatever fluxes are coming, these fluxes or forces we have to estimate. Okay. So one of the important force is nothing but there will be some wall shear stress. And depending upon the situation, if flow is laminar or turbulent, value of this wall shear stress will be changing. So when we are using the wall boundary condition, immediately first thing we have done that whatever the neighboring cells we are having inside the domain or which are lying on the boundary of the domain, for these, we have substituted value of u and v equal to 0. So this is something which we have to do always. And beyond that, because for the adjacent u cell close to the wall, we are not solving the entire x momentum equation. So if we are not solving it, at least because of the wall, whatever the fluxes and forces are coming, these fluxes and forces we have to estimate. Okay. So for finding that, we have to be dependent upon the flow regime. So if how to decide that what kind of flow regime we are having, for that we will be employing this y plus value. So y plus value, if you remember earlier, we have defined as nothing but rho some velocity scale v tau multiplied with some distance y divided by nu. Okay, so that was the value of y plus. Now definition of v tau we know as nothing but square root of tau w by rho. So square root of tau w by rho is something which we call as v tau. Now let us consider that this is my solid boundary, and corresponding to solid boundary, I have some node point over here. So this is my node point of the velocity up. So if this is my node point, so whatever the distance I am having from wall to this node point, that I'll be calling as delta yp. And let me use that delta yp into my formulation. So if I substitute this, I'll be finding rho times square root of tau w by rho into delta yp divided by nu. So that is something which is actually, when I am using rho, I have to consider over here mu, and this mu by rho will be becoming nu. Okay. So this is my y plus value. Now we know that y plus value, even if we are having turbulent flow, then also we are having some laminar sublayer. So over here we are having some viscous sublayer, and after viscous sublayer we are having some buffer layer where viscous and turbulent effects are of equal weightage, and after that we are having some turbulent regime. Okay, so in the turbulent regime we are having some log scale law, log law applicable. In this one, we are having some linear scale. So when we will be using this intersection of log law and this particular linear scale law in my buffer layer regime, so our equation is something like this, y plus equal to 1 by k ln e y plus. So when we will be equating these two, we will be finding linear and log, we will be finding that we are getting some critical y plus value as 11.63, at which both the linear and log law values are actually coinciding. Okay, so it means this is the critical y plus limit. So if our value of y plus, if our value of y plus is less than 11.63 or even less than equal to 11.63, then we can treat our solid boundary in laminar fashion only, though our entire flow is actually turbulent. But in case our y plus value is greater than 11.63, then obviously we have to correct our shear stresses. Okay, so now let us consider first case that we are having laminar flow, either we are having laminar flow or we are having presence of viscous sublayer. Okay, so another thing is we are saying we are having presence of nothing but viscous sublayer. It means we are having y plus value less than equal to 11.63. Okay, so under this condition, we will be considering that our velocity profile is almost linear. So you can see this is the linear approximation which I talked about earlier also. And we will be saying that shear stress will be equal to mu into up times del yp. Okay, and this shear stress fs will be, if
a key from the security, any day class. I'll also do talking about
that. So if this is my shear stress value over here, tau w equal to mu times up by del yp. Now if I have to estimate shear force, shear force will be equal to shear stress into area. So you can see that shear stress is actually acting in the leftward direction. So due to this, for force calculation, we are considering minus sign into area of the cell, which is equal to minus mu up divided by delta yp into area of the cell. Okay, so from here I have got some value of shear force. Okay, so under this condition, when I will be solving the momentum equation, so this shear force actually we can add as some source term. Okay, so we know normally, as I told you earlier, that discretized form is something like this, ap plus sp into phi p. So in place of phi p, when we will be writing for x momentum equation, it will be up equal to summation of a n b into u n b plus s u. Okay, so over here you can see this shear force is actually taking the form of minus u into up by del y p into a cell. So it means if I compare it with s u plus sp into up, I will be finding sp equal to this value. So it means because of the wall, some shear stress is acting, and that shear stress is actually accounted into our x momentum equation in the form of source term. Okay, so this source term, this will be our source term when flow is laminar. And under the laminar condition, say if I am solving for temperature also, so at this boundary, say I have some heat flux type boundary condition, I have some wall heat flux which is specified, or I may have, let us consider, I may have some wall temperature TW which is specified over here. Okay, so this wall temperature, based on this wall temperature, my heat flux at the solid boundary QS will be equal to minus mu CP into TP minus TW divided by sigma delta YP into A cell. So this is something which you will be simply getting if you calculate minus ka dt by dx at the solid boundary. That will be giving you this heat flux value. So over here, this sigma is nothing but your Prandtl number, PR. Okay, and TP is actually the temperature at node point P, and TW is wall temperature, and CP is specific heat, and A is area of the cell face. So now for this also, we will be writing this as source term into our temperature equation. So I'll be comparing it with SU plus SP into TP. So while I'll be comparing SP is becoming equal to minus mu by sigma CP by delta YP into SL, and SU is coming as this condition. Okay. So when temperature is involved along with the flow, we will be having some fluxes also. Okay. So this point is clear. How to include fluxes under the laminar flow conditions? Is this point clear, or do I need to repeat?
Yes, sir. Sir, can you repeat how we will be estimating the value of UP?
How we will be estimating the value of
UP from the boundary condition?
Okay, from the boundary condition. So what I told you, for one of the cell, this value will be equal to zero. So let me consider. See, this is my one U cell, and another U value I will be getting at this point. Clear? So this is the value which is considered equal to zero, and I mistakenly told that we will not be solving equation over here. Here we will be solving actually x momentum equation from J equal to 2. Now, whatever the correction I suggested, is it clear to you?
Yes, sir.
So outside the domain also, here also we are having some V vectors now. So these V vectors we are forcing equal to zero. However, at this V cell, which I have considered over here at Pth location UP, here we are solving the X momentum equation. And in this X momentum equation, because of the presence of this solid wall, we are actually subjecting these wall shear stresses as the forces which are coming. Okay.
Okay, sir. And sir, for defining the scalar values at the wall nodes, so yes, do we use any kind of extrapolation to have the same kind of gradient?
Extrapolation at the moment we will not be using. If fluxes are specified at the boundaries, then we may have to use, but in order to determine the wall temperature value. But if, say, boundary condition is given in the form of Dirichlet form, then we need not to do extrapolation. This point is clear.
Okay, sir.
Now, one important point I would like to highlight over here. So if you recall, this is nothing but our constant temperature of the wall. So because of this constant wall temperature, this much QS solid flux has come. So this Q solid flux, as I have divided into two components, SP and SU, so I will be writing entire wall flux, which is actually going into my scalar or temperature equation, that as nothing but equal to SU plus SP into TP. Okay. And the values of SU and SP are given over here. And in case you are having adiabatic wall, for adiabatic wall, what will be value of SU and SP? Can you tell me?
Zero.
SU equal to SP will be equal to zero. Okay. So this is nothing but because of the temperature boundary condition, we are getting some flux. And that flux we are giving in the form of two source terms, SU and SP. And if we are having adiabatic wall, then it will be simply becoming equal to zero. And if the value of flux is given, then value of flux directly we can substitute into our temperature equation. So flux from the bottom face will be directly known to us. However, if we want to determine the temperature at the solid wall, for that we need to do extrapolation as suggested by Abhishek. Okay. Then comes next situation. If our say Y plus value is greater than 11.63. If Y plus is greater than 11.63, under this condition, what will be happening? We have to employ turbulent relations. Okay. So for employing the turbulent relations, we have to use this logarithmic U plus formulation and logarithmic temperature formulation, this T plus formulation, which is given over here. And these I have already talked about these earlier also. So here sigma TT is actually Prandtl number under the turbulent condition, and sigma TL is Prandtl number under the laminar conditions. Okay. And this P over here, earlier I told it is some function which depends upon the ratio of laminar to turbulent Prandtl number. So you can see over here, here also I have given the functional form for this P. So you can see P as function of these ratio of Prandtl numbers can be obtained from this algebraic expression. Okay. Now here comes the important point. When we are having turbulent flow situation, y plus is greater than 11.63. Under this condition, we will be using this particular equation for wall shear stress, this particular equation for wall shear force. Okay. And once again, when I will be writing this in the form of SU plus SP into UP, I will be getting corresponding values of SU and SP. Then for momentum equation, because normal to the wall always we will be having impermeable boundary, so this will be becoming zero. Turbulent kinetic energy, net source term due to turbulent kinetic energy at the wall will be taking this form. Okay, so this also will be going into our solution in the form of SU plus SP into when we are solving say K epsilon model, I have to consider over here as KP. Okay. Then one important point over here, let me explain. So here you can see we are having KP power 3 by 2. So how to linearize this KP power 3 by 2, that I will explain in the subsequent slide. But at the moment, I am just giving expression of total turbulent kinetic energy source term. Similarly, I am having some source term for dissipative component epsilon also over here. Okay, epsilon P. And for epsilon P, what we do, we don't add source term, rather at the wall we are directly getting the finite value of this epsilon. Okay, and when we are having temperature under the turbulent condition, for temperature now we have to include T plus formulation. So this equation will be equal to now SU plus SP into TP. Okay. So these are the different boundary conditions for which derivation I am not showing. Just I am saying that using these logarithmic laws, logarithmic velocity law and this T plus temperature law, actually we are obtaining these boundary, these source term into our governing equations for the boundary cells. Okay. Now how to incorporate these with the help of source term, that now let me explain one by one. Okay. So for first case, this wall shear stress, if you equate it with SU plus SP into phi P, you will be finding that SU is equal to zero and SP is equal to nothing but the value which is given over here. Okay. So this is how we can add this SP term into our U momentum equation. For V momentum equation, simply we will be substituting normal velocity equal to zero. And when we will be talking about kinetic energy, now as I told you that in case of turbulent kinetic energy, we are having KP power 3 by 2. So this KP power 3 by 2, we can take here by linearizing it. So KP power 3 by 2, I will be writing as nothing but KP star power 1 by 2 into KP. So KP star, I am considering that this is known from previous iteration. Okay, so it is known from previous iteration. So if it is known from previous iteration, then now my KP equation is actually linearized. If KP equation is linearized, I can write it in the form of SU plus SP into KP. So SU, I will be getting this value, because you can see over here, this first part tau W into delta V by delta YP into UP is something which is actually constant part. So that is coming over here, tau W UP delta V by delta YP. And from second part, because it was having some non-linear formulation, so I have linearized it using KP star. Okay. So this KP star 1 by 2 is known to us, and KP we will be including into our turbulent discretization of a discretized form of turbulent kinetic energy equation. And discretized form of turbulent kinetic energy equation will be taking the form AP plus SP into KP equal to summation of ANB into KNB plus SU. Okay, and what are SU and SP for this discretized K equations? These just now I stated over here. Okay, then comes the next part. Next part is nothing but our epsilon equation. And for epsilon equation, so all these boundary conditions I am explaining by considering that I am using the K epsilon turbulence model. Okay, now for this epsilon, as I told you that we are directly having the nodal value, because you can see scalar node is actually scalar node is having directly, I can specify some value near the wall. So that value for the scalar node is obtained using this expression. So if I have to specify this fixed value, what I have to do, I have to give SP as very large value and SU as whatever value we want to specify multiplied with large value. Okay, so this point is clear how we are including epsilon into our discretized form of rate of dissipation of turbulent kinetic energy equation. This point is clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So apart from Abhishek, others are understanding or not?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then we have this temperature equation. So once again, for temperature equation, I'll be writing SU plus SP into TP. So when I'll be doing so, I'll be getting SP as this value, SU as this particular value. Okay. So till this point, our discussion for specifying wall boundary condition is over when we are having actually when we are having stationary solid wall. Okay, so till this point it is for stationary solid wall. And one more thing, when we are using this stationary solid wall, we are considering that our wall is actually smooth wall, because for smooth wall value of E was 9.8 and value of this constant K was 0.41. This K, where K was nothing but this von Karman constant. Okay, so these values are there for smooth wall. When we are having rough wall, then obviously we have to change the values of these coefficients into the consideration of our turbulent flow. Okay, and for laminar flow, these will not be of any importance. Okay, so there are different wall functions available depending upon the depending upon the roughness of the wall, and that wall function nothing but changes these two constants K and E. Okay, then another important part comes when we are having moving wall. So when we are having moving wall, under that condition, wall shear stress will be becoming, instead of directly UP by delta YP, it will be becoming UP minus U wall. Okay, and under that condition, this is for laminar flow condition, and when we are having turbulent situation, then I will be having this as my force, and this will be equation for turbulent kinetic energy. Okay, so all these values will be including function U wall when we are having certain velocity of the wall also. Okay. So is this point clear, how we can include different boundary conditions, different wall boundary conditions with moving wall? Is this point clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Do you have, if you all are free, then can I extend this lecture for 15 more minutes? Or shall I start from the next lecture in only? Please tell me. Can you stay for 15 more minutes?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, then let me complete all the boundary conditions today itself. Okay, then next type of boundary condition we may have constant pressure boundary condition. Okay, sometimes it may happen that say I have some wall and flow is happening through this wall. I am not having the exact data available for velocity, and I have used some manometer, manometric arrangement, or say any other pressure tapping over here to determine the value of pressure. So under that condition, sometimes because measurement of pressure is easy in comparison to measurement of the flow. So if measurement of flow is not available, it may happen that from experimental condition, we are having the value of pressure as known parameter. Now, once we are having value of pressure as known parameter, how that value of pressure actually participate in our inlet and outlet type boundary nodes, that let us try to see. Okay, so this is some inlet boundary, and this is my this scalar control volume. So this is PDES cell over here. Okay, now we are knowing, we are not knowing the value of this UW. So UW is not known to us. I am not even knowing the value of UE, VN, and VS initially. And what we will be doing now at this moment, but what we know the value of pressure. So if I know the value of pressure, it means corresponding to this cell, I know the value of P. So if I know the value of P, I can solve now my all the momentum equations for interior domain. Interior domain means for U momentum and V momentum equation, I can start solving from point I equal to 3 for U momentum, and for V momentum, I can solve as it is how I want to calculate. Okay. So once I will be solving this U and V momentum equation, from there, I will be getting the data of UE, I'll be getting the data of VS, and I'll be getting the data of VN for all my internal nodes. But for this node UW, I don't know the velocity at the moment. However, I am having this value of pressure as known parameter. Okay. So if value of pressure is known to us, so for this particular scalar control volume, we need not to solve, we need not to solve pressure correction equation. Okay. So for this control volume, we need not to solve P dash equation. If we need not to solve P dash equation, under this condition, we will be finding that, or we will be solving the P dash equation, but P dash value will be equal to zero. Why P dash will be equal to zero? Because P equal to nothing but P star plus P dash. And if we are exactly knowing the value of pressure at this node, so it means my P star is equal to P. So if P star is equal to P, all the P dash terms will be zero. So if P dash terms are zero, in my pressure correction equation, I will be having some terms rho UA at east face minus rho UA west face plus rho VA north minus rho VA at south equal to zero. So I will be having this as nothing but my pressure correction equation, which will be equal to continuity equation. Okay. So under this condition, once I have estimated the value of VN, VUE, VS from the solution of interior nodes, I will be just substituting these values in this particular equation. And from here, I can calculate the value of this inflow velocity UW. Okay. So under this condition, you can see that this pressure equation over here, once we are solving this pressure equation is actually helping us in determining the value of velocity UW, and this pressure equation is actually acting as source of the flow. Okay. Because it is trying to pull some fluid inside. Similar holds true for outlet node also. So when for the outlet node, I will not be having the value of U east. However, U west and this U V north and V south will be known to us from the solution of interior nodes. I will be able to estimate the value of U E. So it means constant pressure boundary condition is something which actually results as source and sink boundary. Okay, so we are not over here specifying the value of velocity. We are having the value of pressure. When we are solving that pressure equation by considering P dash equal to zero, we are nothing but getting our value of velocity, which will be for inlet boundary, which will be acting as source of mass or source of fluid, and for outlet boundary, it will be acting as sink for the fluid. So this point is clear, how by knowing the pressure boundary, we can estimate the value of velocities at the boundaries. Is this point clear?
Sir, so and not any boundary condition is given for velocities.
Yes. So for velocity, so, there is no requirement
is
of.
Is that converse true? Is the converse true that we specify velocities and we can get pressure boundary pressure?
Yes. Okay. So see, this boundary condition is nothing but substitution for your inlet velocity boundary condition. So when you are having flow through a pipe, either you can give one inlet, one outlet, either you can give, say, one inlet condition and another as constant pressure condition. You can also give both as constant pressure conditions. So it is up to you what you want, what combination you want to give. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Now let us talk about symmetry boundary condition. So symmetry boundary condition is very, very important. And the only benefit of using this symmetry boundary condition is we can like reduce our simulation domain. For example, if I have flow through a pipe. So flow through a pipe is actually a three-dimensional problem. And in this three-dimensional problem, if I have to solve the three-dimensional continuity and momentum equation over this three-dimensional domain, I will be having large number of meshes. Okay. Rather, if I see the velocity profile of this, so velocity profile of this is actually symmetric about axis of the pipe. So if it is symmetric about axis of the pipe, the meaning of this is that I can consider some, I can utilize this symmetry in order to optimize my simulation. Okay. So how I will be optimizing the simulation? While I will be selecting the physical domain, instead of solving the whole pipe, I will only solve one section, one sector of this pipe or one plane of this pipe along one side of the axis of symmetry, and at this central line I will be supplying actually symmetry boundary condition. Okay. And I need not to then solve this problem as a three-dimensional problem, rather a simple axisymmetric situation by imposing the symmetry boundary condition will help. Okay. So one important thing, let me explain. Under the symmetry condition, we will be having velocity profile something like this. So if velocity profile is something like this, at the symmetry plane, we will be having del u by del y equal to 0. Similarly, any other parameter we are having, so we have to ensure that all the parameters should be symmetric, then only we can apply this condition. So for example, if I consider del phi by del y is equal to 0, so, and another important condition is that because we are saying that at the symmetry boundary condition, there is no gradient available for transport of property. So it means there will not be any flow across this symmetry wall. Okay. So when we are having symmetry boundary condition, we can, we have to specify one thing. First condition is that all normal velocities across symmetry wall are zero. Okay, so there is no normal velocity, normal component of the velocity across symmetry wall, because if there exists normal velocity, that will be disturbing our symmetry. Okay, another thing is that gradient is zero. So if gradient is zero, we will be finding that phi 1 comma j will be equal to phi 2 comma j, where phi 2 j is nothing but our internal node, and this 1 j will be node closest to the wall. Okay, so this point is clear. How to impose symmetry boundary condition and in what scenarios we have to impose symmetry boundary condition?
Yes, sir.
Let us move to our next portion. So this is our final boundary condition, which is called as periodic or cyclic boundary condition. So to explain this, I have one situation of a combustion chamber over here. So you can see this is my domain, and in this domain I have some fuel injector. So fuel is coming through this periphery, and outside that I have some swirling chamber, and that swirling chamber is actually generating some swirl flow into the domain. Okay, so this I have included in cylindrical coordinate system RZ, and over here this is my theta direction. Okay, so now if you see the periphery of this fuel burner, periphery of this fuel burner is having these six different outlets. Okay, and these outlets are actually symmetrically oriented. Okay, now if I take some sector in angular direction, and moreover this swirling flow is also creating some rotation, so because of the swirling flow there is some rotation over here. Okay, now if I consider this particular sector over here between these dashed lines, so this is nothing but a 60 degree sector. So in this 60 degree sector, I have considered one, say along the angular direction, one node as k equal to 1, another node as k equal to nk. So first part is, if I don't have the symmetry condition, I have to solve the entire domain. But you can see over here, we are having some symmetry over here. So under this condition, what will be happening? You will be finding that whatever the flux is entering from this boundary, same amount of flux, if it is leaving from the sector k equal to, from the sector boundary k equal to nk, under this condition we will be having some symmetry which we call as nothing but periodic symmetry or cyclic symmetry. Okay, so what we are having, let me once again say, whatever the flux of any parameter is entering through this, same is the flux of parameter at this boundary. Okay, so it means I can say that del phi by del theta, del phi by del theta at point k equal to 1 is equal to del phi by del theta at point k equal to nk. Okay, so this thing will be only true when the values of upstream and downstream node to this boundary are same as that of upstream and downstream node to this boundary. So what I am trying to say over here, say this cross sign over here nothing but represents the nodes in the upstream boundary of each plane, and circle, open circle, represents the node in downstream boundary. So these cross values has to be same and circle values has to be same, then only these two gradients will be same. Okay, so you can see over here, for phi, for scalar control volume, phi 1j is upstream node for this, and phi nk minus 1 is upstream node for this. These are equal, and phi nkj and phi 2j are the downstream node. These are nothing but equal. And when we will be using for velocity, as for velocity we will be having actually shift by some size delta x or delta theta, so that's why the numbers will be changing for velocity nodes. Okay, so this periodic or cyclic boundary condition is clear. How we can specify?
Yes sir.
If we are using this periodic or cyclic boundary condition, we need not to solve entire three dimensional domain, only we will be solving this small sector. Okay, and another utility of periodic boundary condition comes when we are actually using our multiple processors for solving the same flow domain, means when we are parallelizing our simulation. Okay, so when there is interface in between the two processors, at that point also there should be balance of the fluxes. So in our parallelization also we use nothing but periodic type boundary condition. Okay, now let me give you few final remarks about the boundary conditions, what mistakes we do when we specify the boundary condition. Let me take one case. Say I have this as one solid wall, these three as solid wall, so this is some enclosed chamber, and left side of this I have specified as inlet boundary condition. So can you tell me, is it physically correct?
No sir.
So this is not physically correct, because when something is entering inside, if it is under an incompressible flow condition, we have to have some outlet also. Okay, so this is physically incorrect. So another case can be when we are having some inlet and some outlet type boundary condition. If we are having inlet and outlet, then we need not to specify pressure, because pressure is something which is related to inlet and outlet. If we are also specifying pressure, then it will be actually, problem will be over constrained. Another case can be, I have inlet boundary condition, velocity inlet, and outlet as constant pressure, because constant pressure automatically acts as sink also. Okay. Another case I may have where I will be having inlet as constant pressure, because constant pressure can act as source also, and this as my outlet boundary condition. Okay. And another combination for channel flow can be that both inlet and outlet I have as pressure conditions. So when I have both inlet and outlet as pressure conditions, under this case, velocity will be developed or flow will be developed depending upon the difference of the pressure at inlet and outlet. So means pressure and velocity are inlet conditions. So at a single boundary, we have to only supply boundary conditions for any of these parameter, not for both. Otherwise, our problem will be over constrained. Another important aspect, let me describe that we are having some channel and that channel is having, say, multiple outlets. Okay. So if some channel is having multiple outlets, under this scenario, let us consider at inlet, I have given one inlet boundary condition, and at outlet, say, I want to give some outlet one, outlet two as my boundary condition. So I cannot specify outlet condition for more than one outlets. Why? Because whenever we are having this type of situation, flow through each outlet goes depending upon the distribution of the pressure. So that's why if I am subjecting to more than one outlet as outlet type boundary condition, that will once again result in error in our computation. So outlet type I can only specify to one boundary condition, one outlet boundary. For another outlet boundaries, I have to use constant pressure condition, because flow in multiple outlets is something which is distribution of flow is something which is controlled by distribution of the pressure. Okay, so therefore we cannot impose some known outlet condition, that will be physically incorrect. Okay, so this point is clear.
Yes, yes sir.
Okay, then another thing is while we are specifying the this one outlet type boundary condition, we have to always ensure that we are having sufficient length available behind any obstruction which is actually causing our flow to be disturbed from the fully developed flow situation. For example, say if I am not taking large domain and very close to the obstruction, I am specifying outlet boundary condition. So that will be giving some negative gradients also. Whereas in case of outlet boundary condition, we take del u by del y will be equal to zero. So that will be wrong interpretation. When we are moving further down and if our flow is not yet fully developed, then also though it may be working, but still it will be having poor accuracy. Okay, so for using the outlet boundary condition, we have to always ensure that we are having completely fully developed situation, then only actually we can go for the outlet type boundary condition. Another situation I would like to discuss over here, say we are having some inflow outflow and some flow is entering from this side also. Okay, so here we should not be tempted to use the symmetry boundary condition, because when this flow will be entering, it will be actually disturbing the symmetry about this symmetry axis, and this type of problem we have to solve using complete three-dimensional flow. Because for symmetry boundary condition to exist, one thing is gradient has to be zero, and another thing is velocities normal to the boundary has to be zero, because if there is some velocity normal to the boundary, that is not actually indication of symmetry boundary condition. So these are some of the mistakes which mainly we do while doing the practical numerical simulation. So please take care of these things. Okay, so this point is clear. Is there any question,
sir? In the case of multiple outlets, can we specify all the outlets at constant pressures?
Yes, all the outlets can be specified as constant pressure. For that, there is no issue.
Okay, sir.
Sir, can you show the previous slide?
Yes.
Sir, in this case, you are saying that a reversal of pressure cannot be happen, right?
No. Reversal of pressure will be there, but if in the reversal of pressure, we are imposing this boundary condition del u by del y equal to zero, that will be giving us unrealistic solution. Okay.
Yes, sir. Because in reality case, the velocity will be changing at every point.
Yes. Yes. Along, along
uniformity will be disturbed.
I have to use del u by del x. Yeah. So yes, this will be changing. So we have to ensure that we should have fully developed flow situation. Then only we can use the outlet type boundary condition. Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So I'll stop at this point and